You ready, neighbors? It's just a funny thing, isn't it? This video is sponsored by Brilliant. It's my birthday today! I've got bunting, I've got balloons, I've got a big old Bev, so happy birthday to me. What else could I possibly need right now? And although this birthday of 2020 is destined to be spent indoors, that doesn't mean my mind can't wander. And I've been thinking, if I could go anywhere, where would I go? To the park? To mini golf? To the pub for a pint? Or why not further? And so my adventurous little self has looked at all the planets of our solar system and tried to suss out which has the best potential for a future birthday party. And I would like to point out that what follows are very much my opinions based on these planets' characteristics. I don't want you Saturn fanboys coming after me, all right? Also, if you need me to tell you that this isn't wholly serious, hence why I've missed out various factors vital for survival, then there's me telling you. A fun fact-based joke. Okay, so let's start from the sun and move along, meaning we begin with Mercury. Mercury has barely any atmosphere, which for a party is a red flag straight away. The closest it comes to having an atmosphere is when solar winds blow off some of the surface atoms and make them swirl about, like when you blow the dust off a book you've not read for ages. It's not the best vibe. Also, the sun on Mercury is a bit excessive. It looks 3 times bigger than it does from Earth, and it's 7 times brighter, which is an absolute disaster if you're hungover. I need to think about post-party, not just the party itself, you see. Also, there are no seasons, and I love a bit of seasoning. It's disappointing. So a dusty and dull but weirdly bright birthday sounds pretty poor, to be honest. Let's try and throw Mercury a bone here. What are some potential positives? Well, on Mercury, a year is only 88 days, and because the years go by there quicker than they do on Earth, I'd actually be celebrating my 103.7th birthday, and that means I might get a card from the Queen, because she does that on 100th birthdays. Also, the craters on Mercury are named after famous artists and authors, so if I take a map, I can get some culture in. But perhaps the best thing about Mercury is that it has really deep craters at its poles, the bottoms of which are never exposed to the sun. And it's thought that here, there might be ice, aka frozen water. And we all know what water means. Champagne! You need water to make champagne, you need ice to keep it cool, you need water again to help your hangover that is extra strong because of the weirdly bright sun. It's a real saving grace for what was looking like not a great birthday option. So a birthday party on Mercury would involve me being elderly, cultured, and potentially drunk. I can think of worse things, but I can also think of better things. Next, Venus. Venus spins in the opposite direction to most other planets, so let's get immersive up in here. A day there is longer than a year there, because it takes longer for the planet to spin around once than it does for it to go around the sun once. Did you notice you were the sun there? It's cute. This means my birthday party will last over a year, which is a challenge I will happily rise to. It's one of the most visited planets in terms of spacecraft trying to explore it, which means it's trendy, up and coming, and that's cool for a party, right? To be honest, Venus is looking pretty great in terms of party potential. I can't really see what's wrong with it. Oh, it's a low-key hell planet. Right. Thick sulfuric acid clouds lead to a very spicy situation as they trap in heat and cause a runaway greenhouse effect. And those spacecrafts that visit, yeah, they don't last for more than an hour. Okay, so Venus is a hard pass. What next? Earth? I tried that once and no one came. Move along. Mars. Mars, of course, has lots of people wanting to find life there. So if that's where I host my birthday party, at least some people will be happy to see me. It has some features that are reminiscent of Earth, like valleys, deserts, and polar ice caps. so that could help with homesickness. And there's rovers there that can keep me company if no one comes. Not that I'm expecting no one to come. Also, I've not really spoken about gravity yet, but on Mars, the gravity is weaker than on Earth. It's about 38% the strength. This is perfect for a boogie. I can kind of moonwalk already, but this would level me up to a Mars walk, crushing it. A lack of gravitational force can lead to muscle and bone deterioration, but that's something all too realistic for my fun party video. As mentioned, Mars has polar ice caps and may even have a subglacial lake beneath its southern one. So not only can you pop bottles and keep them cool, but when you do, that low gravity means the cork will travel super far, and that's a great party trick, I'm sure we all agree. Mars has seasons, which is great, and the longest one is spring, which is obviously my fave season. And the Roman god Mars's Greek equivalent is Aries, which is my star sign. It's perfect. Although the red planet's name, Mars, is also symbolic of blood and war. But then again, if it's my time of the month, maybe that'll suit my vibe too. The only negative I can really think of is that on Mars, I'd be 13.2 years old, which sits me slap bang in the middle of some very awkward years. I almost admire my carefree attitude towards washing my hair. Next. Jupiter. Ah yes, the chunky boy. You know, Jupiter tempts me for party time because of the notion of go big or go home. But what I like about it most is that whilst it's the biggest planet in the solar system by far, I can't help but view it as being a kind of gentle giant. Humble. Kind. Like the BFG. If you don't know who the BFG is, he's a childhood character, he's a big friendly giant. And the main character's called Sophie, so obviously as a child I read it. Here I lay out my reasoning for this. When something is related to Jupiter, we say it's Jovian, and that sounds like jovial, which is a nice word. It has a lot of moons, 79 currently discovered, but Saturn has more, with 82. And I like the fact that Jupiter takes second place here. I'm not gonna go for the winner, that's too obvious. Winners are boring, guys, we can admit that here. It's safe space. It also kind of has rings, but they're way fainter than Saturn's. And again, I like that. Jupiter is just like a less know-it-all version of Saturn. And yes, maybe during this video, I've developed a weird hatred for Saturn that I can't fully explain, but I'll get onto that later. For now, let's continue praising Jupiter's party potential. It has the largest planetary atmosphere, so unlike on boring Mercury, we can actually have a party that has a vibe, and there is no water except in the atmosphere, but that's kind of hard to access. But you can BYOB, it's fine. Jupiter is super bright, and we can see it from Earth, which means that people who don't come to the party can look up at it and consider what a sick time they're missing out on. To maintain its humble nature though, a constant storm means it has a big old red spot that it just can't seem to shake. And if that isn't hashtag relatable content, then I don't know what is. Seriously, I have no idea what is. Its discovery hasn't been attributed to anyone in particular, which means Jupiter kind of belongs to us all, and that's wholesome. And also, visiting it is a full sensory experience. Depending on which layer I decide to host the party on, it might smell like rotten eggs, or bleach, or marzipan, and I love marzipan. And if all that wasn't enough, because Jupiter attracts all sorts of comets, it's known as the vacuum cleaner of the solar system. So it's useful too, it's a planet you can take home to meet your mum. The only negative I can really think of is that days are only 10 hours long there, so my party would be pretty short. But that might make it a bit more poetic, you know? Fleeting. Exciting. Yes, there may be storms. And yes, it's technically a gas planet, so there's not really anywhere I can stand, more just a general atmosphere. But that isn't gonna stop me loving Jupiter, alright? Yes, I may only be about 2 years old on it, but I don't care. Also, if I do want solid ground, then there's a wide variety of moon options. There's Europa, which sounds like it's got a synth pop vibe. There's Callisto, which may have a subsurface ocean. I hate swimming. So of course I'd want to do it underneath the ground, where no one can see. It's like Jupiter was written for me, you know? I just have a real soft red spot for Jupiter. Wait, that sounds a bit... Next! Saturn. Alright, yeah, Saturn. So not only does Saturn think it's the best because it's got the most moons, but it also thinks it's edgy because it's got rings. And I'm sorry, but the ring thing is totally tarnished for me because of the number of times I've heard that Beyoncé joke. And then God made Saturn, and he liked it, so he put a ring on it, right? It's just like a less likeable version of Jupiter that thinks it's likeable because it's got rings. Is this the closest to starting YouTube beef that I'm ever gonna get? The day Saturday is named after Saturn, and even though that is a good day for a party, it just makes Saturn more smug. The Roman god Saturn was god of wealth, and the planet is named after him because of its gold look. So Saturn is the capitalist planet. Well, Earth is technically the capitalist planet, but like the other gas planets, it has no true surface. And for some reason, it's only in the context of Saturn that I find this frustrating and suspicious. And also, whilst Jupiter has its great red spot, Saturn has a great white spot, which is just a pus-filled version of Jupiter's. A rumor went around a while ago that on Saturn, it rains diamonds. And whilst the evidence for this has been kind of mixed, lying about it raining diamonds would be such a capitalist Saturn thing to do, and even if it is the truth, I'm sorry, but whilst diamonds are a girl's best friend, not when they're hurtling down from the sky and lodging themselves into my face. So either way, it's bad. It's the only planet in the solar system to have a warm polar vortex, and while that could be snazzy, it's still minus 122 degrees Celsius, and although that's warmer than the rest of the planet, it's still cold to me. I don't like being told something's going to be warm and then it's cold. It brings up my trust issues. In my eyes, Saturn's one chance to bring itself back is the noise it makes. From Earth, we can pick up eerie radio signals from it, and if these end up being fully formed party bangers, then maybe Saturn's soundtrack could be its saving grace. Okay, let's see what we're dealing with here. Okay, no, it's not really my vibe. I want the Weather Girls or something like that. Okay, so Saturn's a no. What about these moons that it's so pleased about? Well, Titan is its biggest moon and it smells like gasoline. Why? Well, maybe because it's got lakes and rain of methane, which is a key constituent of oil and petrol. Again, a capitalist planet with capitalist moons. The only bit of Saturn that I really like is Hyperion, which is another one of its moons, but it's the ugly duckling of the bunch because it's not spherical. Here's a quote about it. Its irregular shape, chaotic rotation, and sponge-like appearance make it a very unique object. Je relate. On the flip side, there's Enceladus, a moon covered in ice. Sleek and smooth, it has geysers that shoot water-rich plumes of gas into the air. Yes, geysers is how I say it. It's one of the most reflective bodies in the solar system and is interesting as F. It even has snow. Look at it, it's like a giant shiny space snowball. But now let's look at Hyperion again. And this comparison makes something pretty clear. At least to me, it's obvious that Enceladus bullies Hyperion. Look at it, it's like the mean girl jock combo I'd never thought I'd see in a moon. And before anyone asks, yes, I was researching Saturn just before lunch, but I'm certain that being hungry did not affect my overall view of it whatsoever. Now can we just move on before I bust something? Uranus. I'm not having a party at Uranus. Not because of the name, but because of how boring it looks. I mean, look at it. It looks like a ball of blue tack I've been rolling around in my warm, sweaty palms for an afternoon. Next, Neptune. Now we're talking. Neptune, I feel like I can get on board with. It has the most powerful wind of any planet. It's so fast that it breaks the sound barrier. And honestly, I love a game-changing wind and a feisty vibe. It was the first planet to be discovered using mathematical predictions, and I love maths. It's the only planet in our solar system that's invisible to the unaided eye, so it's mysterious, and I like that too. Also, Neptune is just a sick god. Like, I'm very afraid of the water because of my poor swimming that I mentioned earlier, but it means I have a lot of respect for Neptune, and Poseidon, and Jabu Jabu, all those water types. A day on Neptune is 16 hours long, which is a pretty good amount of party time. It is minus 214 degrees C, but that isn't as cold as Uranus, I'll have you know. Its blue colour is due to the bit of methane in its atmosphere, but it doesn't smell of much because that atmosphere is mainly made up of hydrogen and helium. It has a moon called Hippocamp, and anyone who knows me knows I love the brain, which features the hippocampus. And the gravity on Neptune is a little bit heftier than on Earth, at 1.14 times the intensity, but to be honest, I'll need something to keep my feet on the ground because I'll be having a party on Neptune, hello! Also, it's thought that Neptune has raining diamonds. Well, not so much raining, more sinking, which feels a bit safer. You see, the top layer of Neptune is that atmosphere I mentioned earlier that's full of helium and hydrogen. But below that, there's thought to be a sort of slushy ice made up of water, ammonia, and methane. Methane is the important one here because it's made up of carbon and hydrogen. It's thought that in the slushy ice layer, the carbon and hydrogen of the methane separate, and then the carbons come together and under high pressure are forced into diamonds. The diamonds are denser than the slush they're surrounded by, and so they end up sinking to the bottom. Voila, sinking diamonds. And to continue the Neptune fan train, I personally just love that it stole that off Saturn. They first thought it rained diamonds on Saturn, and then way more evidence came out that actually they sink on Neptune. So yes, Neptune, steal Saturn's Jupiter. So all in all, Neptune seems like a big blue ball of birthday bants. Yes, the wind may tear me up, but not before I've had chance to tear up the dance floor or dance atmosphere. And that's that. Of course, I know you Pluto stans will be feeling upset at me that I've not given it a full analysis, and I too used to have Pluto as my favourite planet because it's named after the famous Disney dog. But the thing is, if I start talking about Pluto, then I have to talk about all the dwarf planets. And the only dwarf planet I really want to talk about is Makemake, the actual name of a dwarf planet. Hey, want to come to my party on a dwarf planet? Makemake me. Oh, what do you want for your birthday? I don't know, make me something. Honestly, the possibilities are endless. And you know where else the possibilities are endless? On Brilliant. Most of you know that I make videos generally about biology and psychology, but I also studied chemistry, physics, and maths in college, and I absolutely loved them. That's one of the reasons why, for my birthday video, I wanted to do something lighthearted and physics themed, to get back in touch with those subjects that I loved and have a bit of fun at the same time. But my sponsor, Brilliant, have also helped me reconnect with past favourites. Brilliant have an app and a website that teach maths and science through solving problems. Completing challenges of increasing difficulty and taking in knowledge bit by bit means you end up understanding concepts that you might have found difficult or intimidating before. It's way more fun than just learning formulas. There are tons of courses you can check out, but if you're feeling particularly inspired by my planet chat, then why not try this one on gravitational physics? It's a topic I really enjoyed in high school, and it's been great getting my teeth into it again. Working through a course feels like such a good use of time, and it means if I ever do have a birthday party on Jupiter, I can take the risks of the gravity and the gravity of the risks seriously. So if you fancy reconnecting with maths and science, then go to brilliant.org/sophsnotes and you can sign up for free. The link's in the description. And the first 200 of you that mosey on over to that link will get 20% off their annual premium subscription. Happy birthday to you. In terms of my party though, it's looking like Mars, Jupiter, and Neptune are my trio of top picks for the event. But let's be honest, I shouldn't write off Earth so quickly. Yes, I maybe have some bad memories here. But I need to get over those and realise that this is a pretty great place to celebrate a circuit around the sun. Maybe I'll do a big birthday like my 30th on another planet, but for now, I'm gonna stick around here. So it's time for some cake, some dancing, and some staying indoors. But before I go to do that, it's time for your as per every video reminder to like this video if you like it, share it if you share it, subscribe it if you subscribe it, and tweet me if you want, follow me on Insta if you want to do that, and comment if you have a comment. Tell me where your ideal birthday party would be. I am intrigued to see the answers to that. As long as it's not Saturn, don't get me started. And all that's left to say is thank you so much for watching, have a lovely day, and remember to keep partying on. Yeah. And a huge thank you to my patrons, with a special shout out to my new patrons, Philip Mooney and Few Thy Voice, and of course to Adam Dullinger and Terry Cox. Plus an extra special shout out to Robbie the Space Raccoon, who's a low-key legend. It's me. On any of these blah 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 blah. Earth.
This is homemade dust. It's flour and dirt.
So a birthday party on Mercury would involve me being elderly, cultured, and potentially drunk, like an auntie that seems to find their way to every Christmas.
Yeah. Okay. I'm nervous.
Maybe I'll do a big birthday, like my 30th, sorry if that's maybe real old. And if all that wasn't enough, because of Jupiter's gravity and the fact it attracts loads of comets, no, I attract loads of comets. Oh God, it feels like such a forceful thing.